kick it. Welcome to Best Picture This, where it is always Oscar season. I'm Mike.
And I'm Brian. In this show, we reevaluate every Best Picture nominee from the 21st century and decide whether to keep it or kick it from its Oscar pedestal.
But hey, before we're off to the races, I don't want to be a naysayer.
I see what you did there and what you did there too.
But of the stable of movies that we're talking about from 2003, I'm the most confident that this is the one that's not jockeying for a position on your list. Is that fair?
It might lose some races in my heart and mind.
I think I fit six puns in there. Might have been five. In 2003, the nominees for Best Picture were Master and Commander, The Far Side of the World, Lost in Translation, Mystic River, The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King, and today's movie, Seabiscuit, directed by Gary Ross. Here's the trailer.
Shoot him anyway, I'll save you the bullet.
Ref Pollard, Mr. and Mrs. Howard.
Right.
Hello?
The horse is nuts.
Well, at least he wasn't expensive.
Every horse is good for something. You don't throw a whole life away just because it's banged up a little. Just needs to learn how to be a horse again.
How far do you want me to take him?
Charlie stops.
Let's see what you got, boy.
What, fast?
Your horse just broke the track record of tampering.
I just think this horse has a lot of heart.
I'll lay even money that this nag Seabiscuit couldn't even finish six furlongs.
I told you, look out for Rosemont. It's not my fault. Stop, he was flying up your
tail. No, I can't.
What? See out there.
He lied to us.
What do you mean?
He's blind in one eye.
Yeah, don't throw a whole life away just because he's banged up a little bit. Look at us! Our horse is too small, our jockey is too big. Everybody loses a couple, and you either pack up and you go home or you keep fighting.
Kinda small, isn't he? Gonna look a lot smaller in a second, Georgie.
That was rousing.
Are you inspired?
I'm roused.
I like this movie. I feel like I like it less after that trailer because I was feeling like, yeah, I did it. You can watch the trailer and that's the whole movie in a way, right?
Plenty, plenty good. It was nominated for Best Picture, Best Adapted Screenplay, Gary Ross, Cinematography, Editing, Other Stuff. Strange though, there was zero acting, no directing nominations. And that's unusual for Best Picture nominee. Hmm. It was nominated for a Grammy. Randy Newman, the great Randy Newman. He wrote lots of Pixar scores and songs. He's been nominated for 22 Oscars, Randy Newman.
Wow.
That's pretty amazing. Coming up in the show, we'll do our Farley Awards, the most awesome moment of the movie. We'll give our golden takes. We'll also ask each other one question that is designed to fill our dinner plates with the mashed potatoes of truth, regardless of whether we weigh more than 115 pounds. Which I know I do way more than that.
Oh, barely.
You're close. Mm-hmm. You're close. And we will also imagine what might have been, talk trivia, and give the big reveal. Will you keep it or kick it?
But first, our Farley Awards. for the most awesome moment of the movie. And for me, hear me out. I'm going to go with when the kid dies.
That's my Farley Award.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Oh, great. Then we can combine them. So specifically, what's good about this?
Has this ever happened? I mean, you'd think that this would happen a lot.
I don't think so. I think this might be a first in Best Picture this history.
That's exciting.
So the way that they edit this sequence, I think, is the standout.
Mine says, my notes say choppy editing of Jeff Bridges' son's death.
Yeah, I mean,
it's what you just said.
Choppy is one way to explain it, I guess. I mean, I feel like there's a little more finesse behind the, but I kind of like wrote down the beats of this montage because I think that it's very efficient and good. So the little kid, his son, we see him driving a car out to go fishing, and we get a low shot from the back wheel that shows the tires kind of slightly swerve. So we're reminded this kid's not the most confident behind the wheel. Then we're shown a truck driving on the road above him. Cue to the kid changing gears.
We know what's about to happen.
Yes. All we need to see is the truck that's not even on really the same road as him. And then we see the truck again. Then a phone call. Jeff Bridges just says, what? We get a shot of the car flipped over. A different car. It looks nice. Maybe it's doctor's. Pulls into Bridges' driveway. We see him run out for a second, maybe two. Then from almost a different room of the house, kind of like to respect his privacy, we see him cradling the body, sobbing. Maybe 2 seconds. It's barely audible. And then a shot of people standing around a coffin funeral. That's it. It's 70 seconds. Tells a whole story, and I think that we need absolutely nothing more than that.
There's actually also another little detail which I thought was pretty memorable, which is the Cracker Jack floating in the water in the car. Like the whole car has been turned upside down and crashed, but that's one way that it showed, like, you know, it's a child's snack, you know, that's being soaked in water because of the crash.
Would you eat Cracker Jack?
Oh yeah, I did like 2 days ago. I had Cracker Jack. So when I say a child's, I mean child at heart.
Do you have any in your pockets right now,
I
Brian?
Don't, but okay. I might have one of the, I might have a little sheriff's badge or something.
Nice, nice.
I agree. This is also my Farley Award. It's not a typical narrative sequence, but it conveys the grief really
well. Especially in a movie like this.
Yeah,
where you expect them to wring the emotion out and try to manipulate, and this avoids that every step of the way.
So you see this as like a manipulation type of movie?
100%, yeah.
John Schwartzman was the cinematographer, and he actually won the American Society of Cinematographers award that year for outstanding achievement, which I thought was interesting because there's every year there's so many to choose from, but he won first place. This is the guy who also did director of photography work in Pearl Harbor, Jurassic World, and of course what we all know as one of the great cinematography movies of all time, Meet the Fockers.
I've seen zero of those.
Golden Takes. You've never seen Jurassic World?
I haven't.
That was in my movie pass days.
So Golden Takes. I appreciated that this was more than about horse racing. You know, it's also about America and cars and kind of the power of chance, but it's mostly about horse racing. It's about underdogs. I think after I got done with this movie, I sent you a text that just said, I would have rather watched Rocky IV because I mean, that's kind of what it is. You know, the horse is too small, the jockey's too big and half blind, the trainer's too old. That's how they describe them. And yet they keep winning because they've got grit, Brian, and they've got spirit.
They have Jeff Bridges' inspirational speeches.
And he's very good. I do think he's good, and he's good in everything. But like I said, with that trailer, I really do feel like if you watch that trailer, you know exactly what you're getting out of this movie. And maybe that's part of the point. Maybe that's part of the allure. But not really for me. This isn't the kind of experience that I get excited about, although I didn't dislike watching it. And there are things I think to appreciate if you're into that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. If you're into that kind of thing.
If you're into being inspired.
You're trying so hard to be nice. So my golden take is that we are willing to suspend our disbelief for nonfiction more than we're willing to suspend our disbelief for fiction. In this movie, you have, like you said, all that list of why he's big an underdog. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't believe if this was a fictional story about him winning all those races, you'd be like, oh, come on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The fact that he won, you're kind of like excited. It's like a totally different type of suspending your disbelief. And I think that's a pretty cool effect that this movie pulls off, and why a lot of nonfiction movies, a lot of true, you know, based on a true story, movies do well in the box office.
Did they ever answer the whole half-blind question, though? Because they do bring it up, and I thought at some point he was going to get, like, glasses, or they would... I don't know.
I don't think he ever got his eyes fixed. This was before the You know.
Yeah, why even have it then?
Surgery. I don't know. Because it's a true story.
Just because Jeff Bridges could say you don't throw away a man just because Maybe. He's got broken parts.
When Chris Cooper, who is also good in,
he's very good in everything, yeah.
When he said that line at the beginning, you're like, that's coming around again. That's coming around
well,
again.
Well, let's face it. This movie, they do the one-on-one comparison between Seabiscuit and Toby constantly. You know, they break their leg at the same time. When Seabiscuit hurts his leg, Tobey Maguire like jolts out of a dream as if they have some cosmic connection.
And they're standing next to each other, each with the cast on.
Yeah, just like earlier in the movie when they were trying to figure out who could ride this horse. Seabiscuit's angry and trying to get everyone away from him. And then they, you know, pan over to
Toby's
Toby.
Beating people up by the hay bales.
And it's like, these guys are both similar and they need a purpose in life. Put them together. Anyway, questions, Brian.
My question to you is, this movie stitches together its scenes with several devices that serve as narrators.
Okay.
First, you have David McCullough, who is a great historian and has done other documentaries before, but he's not in any other movies, which is interesting. His voice was very recognizable to me, and I had to look it up to make sure who it was. But you have David McCullough in these black and white, like, talking about Henry Ford and all this stuff.
It feels like a Ken Burns documentary.
He did Ken Burns' Civil War. That's partly why I might think of that. Then you have these newspaper montage headlines, sort of like the Spider-Man newspaper ones. Then you have William H. Macy, who's making jokes and making sound effects, and he's hilarious in
the
studio.
My favorite character in the movie by far.
Oh, yeah. I knew that you would love that. Mm-hmm. And then you also have the newsreels in the movie theaters. And when you think about how many times they're doing this stitching together of these newsreels or David McCullough or William H. Macy, and it's all serving a similar purpose of filling you in on the backstory.
Where are we? How many?
This is one of the reasons,
you know,
that it, like, the storytelling really stalls quite a few times for me. But my curiosity, I was curious, which of those four narrative devices did you prefer? Maybe
William H.
Macy.
It. Yeah. It's, and
he's
it's
the
not
most
close.
Entertaining one.
He's just, every time he talked, almost I chuckled
you're
or
like
laughed.
Leaning forward on edge of your
well,
seat.
If you're gonna,
not because you're so excited, but he's gonna entertain you.
Yes, exactly. And like you're saying, if you're gonna, if the whole function of this character or device is to just deliver exposition and let me know where I am in the timeline, give me something else.
Better be humorous.
And
yeah,
he's funny. He makes me laugh. So when he comes on screen, I don't feel like, okay, now I gotta settle in for the Ken Burns documentary.
This is his best movie. Number two, Fargo. This is number one.
You might change your mind. We watch Pleasantville next week.
That's true. He's in that too. As is Toby.
Yes. Same director also. Thomas Newman does the score.
Oh, I actually prefer, I really like David McCullough. He kind of like feels like I'm at home listening to David McCullough somehow. Mm-hmm. And he makes the movie feel this certain authenticity that I thought, you know, a lot of movies try to help place you in history. This one is not trying to pretend like it's kind of feeling like a documentary, and there's plenty of like history that it's giving. And I kind of appreciated that, like, we're dropping pretense and just making it a documentary at the beginning. I kind of liked that. And I do, you know, I just love David McCullough's voice.
And it does kind of ground the movie to try at least to be more about underdogs and horses.
I almost wish that they would have just done that more and dropped the newsreels and maybe keep William H. Macy, because he becomes part of the plot.
Yeah.
But drop the newsreels and drop the newspaper headlines and just give me more David McCullough.
My question to you.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air?
Oh, I've seen so many episodes.
Okay, good.
I can sing the whole song for you if you want.
Should that be the rest of the episode? Me and you just singing the theme song?
Sure.
So if you've seen...
Can you do the extended version where he's on the plane too?
Ooh, that's a tough question.
I don't have that part memorized.
Maybe not. But if you've seen the show, then you know the repeated joke of DJ Jazzy Jeff comes into the house. He hits on Hillary. Uncle Phil doesn't like this very much. Mm-hmm. Uncle Phil throws him out of the house.
I can picture it.
Cut to outside, sprinkler going, and we just see Jazz fly through the air into the grass, and he goes, ah! They have the exact same joke.
With the goat.
In this movie.
With the goat.
Okay.
So are they copying Fresh Prince?
Honestly, I don't know what in the world they're doing here. So they're trying to figure out, like, how do we calm Seabiscuit here? Well, some horses appreciate animal companions, so they bring in this goat, and then we cut to the outside of the stable, and the goat goes flying through the air as if Seabiscuit picked him up and threw him through the window. It is the craziest creative choice
slapstick.
In this movie.
Very slapsticky.
It's absolutely insane. I couldn't believe this story. It doesn't fit at all with the rest of the tone of the movie.
Is that your question?
My question was, have you seen Fresh Prince of Bel-Air? Just because I wanted to talk about this crazy scene.
DJ Jazzy Jeff, the fresh goat. The goat.
The fresh goat. Okay. What might have been?
What might have been? Okay. Tell me yes or no. Robert Duvall instead of Jeff Bridges.
Yeah.
Robert Duvall's amazing. I love Robert Duvall. Have you seen The Apostle?
No.
He's so good in that. Hmm. Jeff Bridges was considered for Travis Bickle in Taxi Driver.
No.
I could see it. I could see that. De Niro, that's kind of like it's iconic. That's how much I think of Jeff Bridges, I guess. Although this is definitely not my favorite Jeff Bridges performance. Jeff Bridges was one of many considered for John Rambo, First Blood 1982.
I feel like there's been another.
Yeah, we talked about another Rambo. I think it was Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, and we brought up the muscles. You need the muscles.
He needs a little more pecs.
Even though First Blood is kind of not really the macho movie that it feels like because of the rest of the series. That one's really about like PTSD and Vietnam. So maybe he could have made sense there.
Jeff Bridges as Batman 1989 instead of Michael Keaton.
No, Jeff Bridges? No. You need that.
Is it because Michael Keaton is so iconic in that role?
Yes.
Because I don't think he's that iconic.
Well, first, you're wrong. And second of all, you need his like manic energy. You need to know that he's a little crazy underneath like the Bruce Wayne leveled.
The dude doesn't have a little craziness?
Not manic craziness.
Okay, this is not a what might have been, that's for real, but what about Robert De Niro as that Batman?
Okay, now I can see a little bit more darkness in there.
And the sort of silly dope of the serial killerness in Taxi Driver.
Yeah.
It's a little bit of both.
I do like the idea of Batman being a little bit insane, so yeah. I could
see
it.
He has to be driven by revenge. Jeff Bridges turned down the lead role in Pretty Woman. And Ghost. Interesting.
Okay.
Trivia. The movie describes War Admiral as this huge colossus, 18 hands tall. In real life, he was 15 hands tall, the same height as Seabiscuit.
Oh, really? Wow.
What is the deal with that?
You need a villain, I guess.
Come on. I mean, if you're going to lie about stuff in the movie, don't be that cheap to make him a tall, big, huge
He's
monster
gotta be
of a
an
horse.
Underdog, man. How
that
is he
made
possibly
me lose respect
win?
For the movie here when I heard that.
You know how I feel about keeping
I
true
do,
to the facts, so I'm fine with it.
But even a fact like that, like it's like, and Toby wasn't, you know, Toby's character actually had only one arm, but in real life he had two arms. So why are you doing that?
I'm not here to learn. It's fine.
Most of the audiences at the Pimlico race with War Admiral in the movie were blown up mannequins.
Oh, I
with
like
face
that.
With masks as faces, long sleeve t-shirts, painted on suits, plastic hats, which were all provided.
Wow. Cheaper than CGI.
I was thinking maybe we should get like a live studio audience of mannequins. Blown up mannequins.
Would that make you feel important?
I think it would, yeah.
Okay, I'm down.
Like, what do you guys think over there on the couch?
We need an applause track though.
We do have an
and
applause
a laugh track.
We do from the other radio show that Mark helps us produce, Mark Gilliland.
Illustrious producer.
I wonder if that applause track could be used in our show. Having just played Spider-Man, Tobey Maguire had to lose 20 pounds of his Spider-Man muscle so he could play this role.
And put it right back
Apparently,
on for the following.
Apparently, he must have put it back on.
Yeah, that's cool.
Man.
You love a body transformation.
I love a body transformation. Tobey Maguire also got $12 million for Seabiscuit.
Solid.
Thanks in part to his Spider-Man success.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right, Mike. I have a feeling you're going to try to tell me how bad you think the movie is, and then you're going to secretly keep it.
I am not going to do either of those things. This movie is not bad. It's just exactly what I thought it would be with almost no exceptions. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to kick it. It's not the type of movie that gets me excited. I'd like to be surprised when I turn on a movie, Brian. And if I'm not surprised, even if the movie is solid, I feel like it's a little bit lukewarm.
But you were surprised by War Admiral being short.
Not so much.
I will definitely kick the movie. I think that it is my least favorite Best Picture nominee since the Cider House Rules.
So you just hate Toby.
I'm not a big fan of Toby. I don't think, I think he probably is a very nice person, but I just am not usually very convinced by his characters. I am interested to see him in Brothers, which I have never seen before. I actually have Dark the DVD Toby. In my box in my bedroom right now, and mm-hmm. it might still be in the plastic wrapping. I just have never opened it, but I'm interested to see Brothers.
Yeah.
But one of the things is that the backstory stuff at the beginning is very long, and it's probably the best stuff in the movie, where he loses his son.
Mm-hmm.
He, you know, leaves his wife, meets Elizabeth Banks. Toby loses his family.
Mm-hmm.
That stuff is very engaging to me. And then it never seems to be even remotely pertain to the rest of the story. Like, the only other hint that you get that Jeff Bridges is mourning for his son still, which I think that he is, and that might be why he kind of does, you know, sort of adopt Tobey Maguire's character.
Yeah.
The only other hint you have is when they're like playing with that little, you know, little ball game.
Yeah.
Other than that, you don't really see that revisited. And Toby, I mean, apparently he just lost his family and that was it. And he never seems all that sad about his family. He just is angsty. But that seems really odd to me that you would not use that again somehow. And well, I think that's kind of makes the movie a little bit feel a little less satisfying to me.
I guess so, but also at the same time, that is something that I expect a movie like this would have done, and I appreciated that they stayed away from it, because what makes Toby good is his sort of anger and volatility because he was cast aside by, or he felt that way by his family.
Yeah.
And what makes Jeff Bridges do what he does here is because he lost his family, and so he gets obsessed with the future. He keeps saying over and over again, the future, that's like his catchphrase. So this is, it's kind of a desperate thing in a way, you know, he's, instead of dealing with his problems, he's throwing himself into horses because he locks up all of his cars, and which I thought was a little bit much. He loses his son in the car and then he just gives up on cars.
I know. I mean,
come on. Cars don't kill people, you know? People
just like
people.
Guns don't kill people.
Exactly.
That's all not right. A political statement, by the way. That was just a bad joke.
Yeah. I'll skip Letters to save some time, but I'm going to kick it. You're going to kick it. That's two kicks. That's two kicks, I think.
Two boots up.
For the first time in a while, two kicks.
That's true. We haven't done that much. In the next episode, we talk about Monster. It's another true life story. So in the same category, really, as Seabiscuit, right?
Yeah, for sure.
This time it's about a serial killer played by Charlize Theron, directed by Patty Jenkins.
We want to hear from you. Were we too dismissive of Seabiscuit? Did we treat it unfairly?
I wasn't, but I think you were.
Let us know and we'll read your answers on the show. You can find us at bestpicturethis.com, on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, or by telling your smart speaker to play Best Picture This. We're also on Facebook and Twitter at Best Picture This. And for 15 years of golden takes, head over to Letterboxd where you'll find me, Mike Cavalieri.
Do you have a favorite movie from the past that doesn't get the attention it deserves? Go to patreon.com/bestpicturethis. Become a patron of this show and help choose a future movie episode.
Thanks to WNZF and Mark Gilliland for producing. And please remember to rate, review, and subscribe to the show on Apple Podcasts.
Until next time, here's some life advice for you, Mike.
Okay.
Or for our listeners.
Great.
You already know this.
Yeah.
If you get thrown off of an episode of Best Picture This, get right back on.
Mm-hmm.
You can do this.
Mm-hmm.